trying to split into the subclasses. So the objective of these enhanced or maybe these additional features or advanced features in ERD is to add more details, more semantics to a particular ER diagram, right? Because in very few or exceptional cases, it is possible that there are some information needs to be there. There are few clarity on the entities are needs to be there, right? For that purpose, we are basically adding these some additional details on our ER diagram, particularly on the entity, not on relationship, not on attribute. So if you see in a ER diagram, we could have possibly three main elements. Right, so relationship is naturally there, relationship, and then we have attributes of entity. But these the possible addition we will be going to discuss on a ERD is on entity. So in ERD we have base entity. Now along with adding attributes, now we will be going to understand why there are this need of adding more details into ERD on entity element, right? So one particular example we can take that we have in the previous classes, we have discussed this database of organization on a database of a company where we have various employees in one entity, employee entity, and we have this department entity, and we have this what you can say project or maybe department location like thing, right? So basically a dependent kind of thing. So basically if you see the employee entity, particularly there we have list of employee, but if you try to understand that what is the nature of each employee, it is not possible that each and every employee is having same kind of skill set or maybe same kind of work or maybe same kind of designation. So if you want to understand the different aspect of entity, right? So suppose you want to understand different type of employees, different other aspect of employees in an entity, kept in an entity employee, we need to perform some kind of specialization, right? So specialization means based on some specific attribute, you are trying to understand the different possible subclasses or subset or maybe groups within this whole employee set. So it will naturally for some objective or some purpose, we are not performing this task of specialization just for fun or any compulsion, right? We are performing specialization on an entity. It is always this kind of rule. Whenever we will be performing some kind of specialization, it is because of some need, right? Because eventually we will be segregating or creating subgroups within the employee entity. So eventually we can perform the activity of specialization on any entity, right? Whenever we have more than one, or you can say more than one column or one more than one objects in entity, right? क्योंकि उसके बिना तो कोई पॉसिबिलिटी नहीं है. अगर एक ही एट्रीब्यूट है, एक ही टपल एक्चुअली, तो फिर ऑलरेडी स्पेशलाइज्ड है, राइट? सो व्हेनेवर वी हैव एटलीस्ट मोर देन वन टपल और वन रो और वन ऑब्जेक्ट इन एन एंटिटी, यू कैन परफॉर्म स्पेशलाइजेशन. एंड टू परफॉर्म स्पेशलाइजेशन यू नीड टू हैव एटलीस्ट वन कंडीशन, वन प्रेडिकेट, वन एट्रीब्यूट नेम बेस्ड ऑन विच यू कैन क्रिएट द specialization. So if you have a database, there we have an entity called a student, right? So if you have a student's details like your student name, their DOB, their date of birth, their email IDs, their degrees which they have completed or which they are pursuing, and skill set they known, and likewise. So let's take we are capturing the companies where they placed. So now if you want to perform specialization to select few students for certain company, so what could be the specialization attribute we can use? So based on this basic nature of basic attribute of entity student, which attribute you will be using to perform specialization, can you tell me? So suppose you are running a company for some kind of data science organization. So skill is one possible thing. Other things you can do. So naturally, whenever we perform a specialization, it will be based on only one attribute, right? It will not having more than one. So grades will not serve purpose. Grades will be for something else, right? So so likewise, you can say select any specific purpose. So similarly, if you say in a company, suppose we have a company database. Suppose we have an entity called employee. Now, what could be the specialization criteria or specialization attribute to see or to perform this salary revision? What could be the criteria? Can you tell me? Yeah, can you tell me? So suppose company wants to revise their salary, so what could be the criteria for performing this activity? Because you need to see the different classes, different groups of employees to perform this salary revision, right? So whenever we want to perform some kind of salary revision, the first criteria could be if you are maintaining the number of hours. Like in our database, we have maintained that how many number of hours one employee is working on a certain project, right? So one criteria could be number of hours. Second criteria could be other things like experience you are sharing, work time is naturally that is there. Experience, performance, right? So likewise, so it is important to have this kind of segregation or clustering of the objects in entity, right? So it is very obvious and it is very clear that so suppose for an entity you are trying to create subgroups and subclasses. Likewise, so your basic entity is considered as a superclass because it is having all the possible objects. Now the activity of specialization is trying to create the subclasses, subgroups, something. So all the entities which have been created through this based or superclass entity will be considered or called as a subclass, right? But there are two possibilities. Whenever we have this main employee entity, and suppose in this main entity or superclass entity, employees having 100 employees, so there is two possibility. Whenever we are creating subclasses, so let's take there are three possible subclasses of this entity employee. Now, if you create the subclasses, there is not necessarily imposed that all the 100 employees are classified into these subclasses, right? It is not possible. Sometimes it is not possible. Sometimes it is possible. Sometimes it is possible to create all objects into some classes. There is no object left from an entity. So specialization is referred as a total participation. Again, the same thing concept we have taken, total participation, partial. So total means total. So when we say we are performing a specialization with total participation, it means each and every object of an entity is falling into some class. It is going into a class, right? And secondly, naturally, if we say it is partial, it means there are some objects which could not be segregated or specialized into some subclasses, right? Primarily. So we have two possible options of participation of entity or possibility of participation of object of an entity into a class, right? If it is total, it means each and every object of the class will be going into some subclasses. And if it is partial, it means there are some objects which are not fitting into any subclass, right? That is the possibility. That could be one possibility. Similarly, if you perform this specialization, there are two possibilities. That one possibility is that each object is going into one subclass, but sometimes it is possible that there are some objects, there are some row or tuple which is falling or may belongs to more than one class, right? So first scenario is that each subclass is having its own set of attributes, its own set of objects, and this object is not overlapping with other. So each and every subclass, so for let's say for one main superclass or one entity, we have created three sub entities or three subclasses, and these three subclasses are having their own mutually exclusive set of objects. सो फर्स्ट सब फर्स्ट सब क्लास में लेट्स से 30 हैं, दूसरे में 30 हैं और तीसरे में 40 हैं. सो ऑल दीज 100 एम्प्लॉइज आर केप्ट नाउ केप्ट इन 3 डिफरेंट सब क्लासेस एंड देयर इज नो देयर इज नॉट अ सिंगल ऑब्जेक्ट और देयर नॉट अ सिंगल एम्प्लॉय हु बिलोंग्स टू मोर देन वन क्लास. सो दिस काइंड ऑफ स्पेशलाइजेशन इज referred as a disjoint. We are not having any common or overlapping things, overlapping objects, overlapping employee, right? So all the 100 employee of the organization are mutually exclusive, means we are keeping them into 3 different disjoint classes, right? That is one possibility. And opposite to this is possible that there are few employee who are falling into more than one, who belongs to more than one subclass. So this kind of specialization is referred as a overlapping, right? So we have two possibility, disjoint and overlapping. And previous to that, we have discussed the participation thing. So we have actually, whenever we perform specialization on an entity, we are trying to now elaborate or expand the entity to understand its properties for some objective, for some purpose. So whenever we perform this kind of exercise, this kind of activity on a particular entity, we have to see about two constraints. First constraint is the participation thing, that what is the nature of participation of a main entity with their sub entities, how they are falling, right? That is first constraint. Second constraint is basically is the nature of belongingness, right? So first possibility in that is disjoint, where we will be having exclusive sets, exclusive objects on these subclasses. Second possible alternative in this is overlapping, that in this subclasses we have few objects which may belongs to more than one class, right? So this is something about specialization. So specialization objective of specialization is to create the subclasses naturally, to understand each and every the nature of each and every objects, each and every tuple record, to understand in better way. Similarly, if you have to, so basically there is a concept which is altogether opposite to this generalization. It is referred as a, so one thing important is here is that you have to understand that what is the nature of specialization. So you can say that specialization is something kind top to bottom. So we are creating bottom entities. So we have one super class or one entity. Now we are creating 3 or more than one entities. So it is like we are expanding the objects of an entity to understand it in a better way. So similarly, if you have top to bottom kind of approach to understand the entity, we can have an approach called bottom up. Means we are having different entities, different various entities, and now we are trying to converge them into a single possible entity. Naturally, to converge or to basically integrate entities or to merge the entities, you need to perform some kind of abstraction, some kind of overlapping, right? So whenever we have more than entity, now you want to converge them into single entity. So the first thing you have to see the possible number of overlapping or common attributes, right? What are the different common attributes? Common attributes means you can have two entities. First is having first name, second is having F name, something like that. So first is having DOB, second is having date of birth. First one is having email ID, and second is having other names. So you have to see the possible common attributes among these pair of entities or more than one entities. And now you derive a one common super class entity, super entity, which will have all these attributes, common attributes, and with this new name, right? Because we have created this entity, so you cannot take the name of any parts. So let's say, so you suppose you have two entities, you cannot take the name of first this entity to make a new super entity, right? So basically this the whole approach, bottom up approach, is referred as a generalization. We are generalizing, we are commonizing, we are making common, right? Something like that. So basically these two features are basically important to understand, manipulate or modify the entity. Now let me take a few seconds to share the a particular example, right, so that we can understand it in a better way. Phone tab, present now, window, come out. Yes. So, just a minute. Okay, so let me see. Yes. Present now, window. Okay, now let me try again. Why it is failing? Yeah, just a minute. Let me cast it. Source file. So I'm trying to cast a file, local file. So I hope till this point things are clear with you. Clear to you? Are they finally all files? Yeah, okay. So something is being shared. So let me see. Okay, now I need to share and stop sharing. I am facing a little difficult, so I'm trying to cast a file. Because it is creating some problem. Yeah. Yes, perfectly fine now. Okay, I hope this is visible to you, right? Now it is getting ready. You are presenting to everyone now. Okay, so yes, this is the example I'm trying to explain. So for, this is the class note. So from this, we can take this typical scenario of employee. Now you can easily understand why we are stressing upon the different constraints while performing specialization on entity, right? So if you could see, so employee, now this picture is basically having specialization defined into it. Already some kind of specialization is performed, right? And that is for different purpose, right? So we can, for a single entity, we can have different specialization, different instance of specialization based on the some kind of criteria or maybe based on some kind of attributes, right? So you can see there are three specialization performed. So three specialization for the employee, it is clear, right? So let's understand that. So we assume that we have around 100 employees again, and among these 100 employees, there are different types of employee. So when I say types, so the one type could be based on, you can see the first specialization is based on some kind of skills, right? So you can see the subclasses of these 100 employees are like, it could be some employee could be working as a secretary, and then another could be acting as a technician. We have possible types of other employees are engineer, right? And if we say we are defining this specialization of an entity employee, with the nature of D means disjoint, means all the 100 employees will be kept in these three, or could be in these three subclasses. That is one specialization, possible specialization for some purpose, because it is possible that some higher management or higher authority is trying to understand that what is the current staff type, what is the skill type of. So you can understand that based on some type of skill, we have this first type of specialization, right? So here we have kept D. D means disjoint, and this constraint, this participation is not total. This participation is partial. It means there are some employee left in the end. There are some employee left, and they are not falling into these secretary, technician, and engineer subclasses, right? So it is not possible because it is not possible, or it is not done because this nature of specialization is not able to map each and every employee of entity into these three subclasses, right? So that's why we have kept in D. This symbol is of specialization. We are performing specialization downwards. So, but in case of generalization, it will be reverse of it, right? So we will see it in the next few discussion. So now, if you see, there is another classification, and it is based on the nature of cell, something like that. So this specialization is basically of nature total, right? Because this specialization is defining the subclasses of employee entity based on the salary, nature of salary, right? Nature of salary. So it is naturally important that each and every employee is falling into some category, some class, right? Because each and every employee is getting some kind of salary. So that's why we cannot have here a partial participation. We are getting salary. So each and every employee is getting salary. That's why we need to perform some kind of total participation of employee entity into its specialization classes, subclasses. So participation is full, which is total. Now this constraint of separation or presence is disjoint again. Disjoint means we are having a clear two subclasses. There is no confusion, right? So we have 100 employees. So each class will have exclusive set of employees. So first subclass will be salary employee. Second subclasses could be hourly employed, basically, right? So salary employee is one employee whose salary is computed based on his job, not on the hours basis, right? So similarly, we can have another class of employee which is getting salary based on number of hours they work. So whole set of employee basically now get into two subclasses, two specialization or specialized subclasses, right? So similarly, so further we have done specialization for. So basically they have created some kind of relationship. So hourly employee is basically belongs to trade union, something like that. So this is kind of information we get whenever we perform. So you have seen that in company database, when we have created employee, we could not have possibly seen this possibility of trade unions or something like that. So whenever we perform specialization, there is this need of additional details, right? So whenever we create subclasses, you can easily realize that there is need of addition of some other details, right? Because without this actually belongs to trade union, this whole presence of hourly employee will be questioned, right? Right, they can be having some query that why they are kept here and how, what is the definition, something like that. So whenever we extend, whenever we specialize the entity, there could be the need of adding some additional details in the form of relationship or maybe in the form of entity itself. But it is not necessarily the case always, but in some cases, right? Similarly, if you go to the third possible specialization, not a specialization, basically we are creating some kind of relationship. So employee is basically one possible specialization is managed. So along with these two possible specialization, first is based on skill, second is based on this salary nature. Second, third possible specialization is based on it's a job type. It is again, or maybe designation, it is all manager. So in this company, there are company employee, there are some employee who are working as a project managers, right? So we can create a subclass. We can create a subclass of employee entity as a manager, and we can have a different relationship defined with this manager entity to explain the this relationship called manages project, right? So this possible instance of relationship entity has not been extended or elaborated in the ER diagram which we have drawn, but now we, because we are creating the subclasses or maybe the subsets of our employee set, we can identify this possible existence of relationship called manages and its dependency with project entity, right? So this is one particular instance where we have understand that how you can place the constrained information. So whenever we perform some kind of specialization and there is a possibility of more than one subclasses, we need to place this constraint D, right, which refers to what, which indicates that each and every subclass will have different or distinct or mutually exclusive set of objects into it, and we can have overlapping also. Overlapping means there are some objects of each subclass or maybe any subclass which is having belongingness to more than one subclasses, right? Similarly, you can have this indication of total participation and partial participation based on your understanding. Similarly, let's take another example. Now you can see, so here we are having overlapping things. So let's take that in a warehouse or maybe in a company, we have kept the different spare parts or maybe any parts, actually spare parts or maybe accessories, any kind of thing. So we could have two broad subclasses of it. So parts, so in parts entity you can see the part number and description. So one thing is important here. Now you need to see that we are keeping only part number and description with the part entity. Part entity is the main entity, base entity. Now when we perform a specialization, it will basically results into two possible subclasses or some entities, and you have to move the respective or relevant attributes with these subclasses. So when we begin with this ERD specialization, in the starting of specialization we have only one single entity which is called part, and in this part entity we could have possibly all these 3 and 5, so basically 5 objects. So 5 plus 2, so basically in the beginning of specialization, when we start this specialization activity, at that point we have this part entity with 7 attributes, right? 7 attributes. Now when we perform a specialization, we identified that some parts are of nature or maybe type manufactured part that the company has designed or basically created or manufactured that plant, manufactured that part, and some parts are purchased from another company which we have kept in our warehouse. So if you perform a specialization of these parts based on their by nature or maybe the type of parts, we have kept these parts, all of the whole set of parts, into two subclasses. First is called manufactured part, second one is referred as a purchase part. Now because it is overlapping, it means there are a few parts which may belongs to both purchase part and manufacture part, both classes, because it is of nature overlapping. And for this manufactured part entity, we could have defined or we could have separated these 3 attributes: drawing number, batch number and manufacture date. But if you see the attributes nature or name in the purchase part entity, it is altogether different, right? So whenever we perform specialization, first you have to understand identify that what is the criteria, what is the attribute type based on which I am going to perform specialization. That is first thing, right? Now naturally specialization will create subclasses, so you have to see which attribute will be going to which subclasses, right? And third thing, whenever we will place all these attributes into some subclass or subentity, what will be the constraints, nature of constraint, whether this specialization will be total or partial, whether this subclasses will be of nature disjoints or overlapping, right? So these are the 3 things you have to take care of whenever we perform some kind of specialization, right? So going to next part, which is generalization. So okay, there is another example of this is a typical case of institute database, some kind of college management system. So suppose we have drawn a whole ER diagram in our college management system, and in that we have seen this entity called person. So person captures all the living human being in a college, right? So the first of possible type of socialization will be employee, alumnus, and student. And now it is showing overlapping, right? So you can understand that why we have kept overlapping at this level, because there are some employee who could be alumnus to this institute, jinhone wahi se padhai kari, wahi job kar rahe hain as employee, right? Similarly, there is a possibility that some alumnus could still be studying in the institute, right? Jaise kuch log BTech karke MTech bhi us institute se karte hain. So in the database of company management system, college management system, students who are pursuing the second degree in the same institute will basically available or will present in both alumnus as well as student, something like that, right? So that's why we are keeping this level of specialization as a overlapping. Now you can see we have further specialized this entity employee, right? And now this employee entity is specialized into three disjoint subclasses: staff, yes, faculty, yes, there may be some students who are working in the lab assistant, something like that, right? So based on some criteria or some attribute, we have created subclasses, three subclasses. And similarly, if you see, there are this entity named the student, it is further specialized into this disjoint subclasses. First is called graduate student, and second subclass is called undergraduate, right? And parallel, you can see there is a third possible type of specialization, which is called student assistant, right? And this particular entity is referred as a shared sub, because this is subclass which is shared by two subclasses. So student employee ke liye jo ek subclass bana tha wo student assistant hai, and it is common with the student subclass, right? So ye bhi possible hai ki there is a subclass which could be shared by more than one subclasses, something like that, right? And based on this, we have created a new level of specialization, which is called which is basically for classifying these student assistant kyun kis type ke hain. To wo kuch student assistants hain jo wo research assistants hain, right? Or kuch teaching assistant, something like that. So it is basically endless task. It is based on the understanding of the domain ki aap jo system bana rahe hain uske domain ke bare mein kitna acha idea hai. So first we draw the basic entity, we identify the basic attributes. The next task is to identify or draw the possible specialization. And naturally, it is not compulsory to draw the specialization subclasses for each and every entity, right? Aisa nahi hai. Ye basically aapko tab perform karna hai whenever it is requested, whenever it is desired to perform this kind of activity for some purpose, some for task, right? So I hope till this point things are clear. Now we are going to the generalization, which is the exactly opposite practice, right? Exactly opposite practice. Now you can see this typical three entity. So basically we have two entities, because generalization is something, it is used to create the super class. It is bottom up approach. Now with generalization, we can create a single possible entity of all other different or distinct entities, right? ये तब होता है, actually ये typical case तब होगा जब आप दो databases को merge करेंगे. So let's take instance कि दो hotels थी, वो business में merge हुई, उनके databases अलग थे, तो naturally database merge होंगे. So basically this generalization is important there only. Whenever we are collaborating two entities, whenever we are integrating two distinct or two different entities or databases even into one. So there are various entities on these two databases which are similar, so we can combine them, we can create a generalized class, right? So hum keh rahe hain ki okay, initially we have two entities. First is car. Car entity hai jisme number of passenger hai, price hai, maximum speed hai, vehicle id hai, license plate number hai. Similarly, if you can have second entity called truck. Truck is having price, number of place, tonnage, waiting capacity hoga shayad, vehicle id, then license plate number. So if you can see now, because of some reasons we want to perform some kind of generalization between or by using these two entities. Now if you see, it is very obvious that all the attributes which are having similar participation or similar kind of position, like price is common in both, something like that. Maximum speed is not there in the truck. So all the common attributes you can have in the entity which we'll be deriving as a super class or super entity, something like that. But all the remaining attributes will be there in the subclass. So you can see in the bottom diagram, bottom entity, we have created a super class called a vehicle, right? So vehicle is something you can use as a common or super class entity, and this you need to do, right? You cannot take the name of car or truck here in the super class. So for super class, you need to create, you can define a new entity name. And in this super class entity, you will be placing all those common attributes, common between the all participating entity, right? And this participation is total naturally. And this nature of participant is disjoint, right? Mixed. We can have car with the truck type of nature, something like that. We cannot have that. That's why this participation is disjoint and total. Right, and still there are few attributes kept with the each and every participating entity, car and truck, something like that. So we have kept maximum speed with this car and number of axles in the truck at one age. So because these attributes are specific to these subclasses, right? So basically, this is a typical example of generalization, and whatever constraint we have discussed for specialization will be applied for generalization. So whenever we perform generalization or whenever we perform specialization, we need to see what? We need to see first, at the first level, we need to see the possible criteria, possible attribute based on which we will be performing this generalization and specialization, both ways. So whenever we perform something on entity, it will be based on, first you have to identify, it will be based on attributes or maybe single attribute. That is first thing. Second thing, in case of specialization, you have to see the flow of attributes which are specific to subclasses. So from the common entity, from the super entity, you have to drag the attribute to the subclasses. In the case of generalization, you have to move the common attributes to the super class, something like that, right? Okay, so with this, actually, we have completed the discussion planned for today's class. Okay, this whole thing is something important. You can understand that, sir, what we have done here, for this whole database, which is called as a university database, we have actually tried to elaborate the ER diagram by using specialization and generalization, right? So this whole picture is basically describing the complete EER, which is enhanced EER diagram for the database, right? So with this I am stopping share. Now if you have any particular query, you can discuss with me now, right? So you can discuss it. You can post your query. I'm waiting for your query. So because we have at least 5 minutes now. So things are clear. Can you confirm?